I invite you, if you're able, to please stand for the call to worship. God anointed Christ to console the afflicted.
Come, let us worship the Lord, our Comforter.
God anointed Christ to emancipate the enslaved.
Come, let us worship the Lord, our Liberator.
God anointed Christ to bind up the wounded.
Come, let us worship the Lord, our Healer.
God anointed Christ to deliver the troubled.
Come, let us worship the Lord, our Savior.
Come, let us worship the Lord of all. To confession this morning. Prepare the way of the Lord. Let us join together to make our confession to God. Let us pray. Merciful God, in baptism you grafted us into the body of Christ, prompting us to forgiveness of sin and newness of life. But we fail to live as forgiven people. We keep destructive habits and hold
Amen.
Friends, hear the good news. Though we are unworthy, we are granted God's favor in Jesus Christ and are baptized into the church of his beloved Son. Friends, believe the good news.
In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
Good morning. I'd like to invite the children to come down front for a few minutes. Got some fancy cushions for you to sit on today. We're going to be here for a while. So good morning. Oh, no. Good morning. All right, good. I was just making sure you were awake. It's great to see you today. This morning, I want to talk to you about spreading the news. Back in the day, long time ago, when they wanted to spread the news, they had these people called town criers. And they'd walk out in the middle of the town and they'd say, "Hear ye, hear ye." And then they would tell what the news was. And that's how people got their news. And then a little bit later, we had this invention called newspapers. And so we had newspaper boys. And they'd go stand on street corners and they'd say, "Extra, extra, read all about it." And they'd say the headlines that were on the newspapers to get people to buy the newspapers so that they could get the news. And today we have a lot of different ways that we get news. We've got radio, TV, internet, we've got a lot of different ways that we can get the news because it's important to know the news and to know what's happening. Well, back in the Bible, long before Jesus was born, God spoke through the prophet Isaiah, and he told how he was going to spread the good news about Jesus. And through the prophet Isaiah, God said, "I will send my messenger to prepare the way for the coming Lord." And that messenger, we're going to read about him in Scripture later today, was a guy named John the Baptist. And maybe you've heard about him. And you see, John the Baptist was an odd dude, all right? He wore clothes made of camel hair and a leather belt. And he ate honey and locusts. Locusts, they're like grasshoppers. That's not very tasty. But he was weird, but everywhere he went, he'd tell people that Jesus was coming. And he'd help prepare the way by telling them to ask forgiveness for their sins and trust in God. So even though he was weird, no matter where he went, he spread that same message. And well, it's been over 2,000 years since God sent Jesus to earth. But God still needs messengers like John the Baptist. He still needs messengers to spread the good news about God and Jesus. Can you help spread the good news about God and Jesus? If you can, say, "I can." Awesome. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for today. We thank you for helping us spread the good news just like John the Baptist. In your name we pray. Amen. If you're heading to Children's Church, you can go that way, or you can head back and have a seat.
If you would join me in the prayer for illumination found in your bulletin. Loving God, you provide for our every need. You feed our bodies and our souls, yet we hunger to know and love you more and more. Nourish us with your word today. Through Jesus Christ and in the power of the Holy Spirit, we pray.
Scripture reading today is from Luke's Gospel. It's found on page 60 in the New Testament section of your pew Bibles. Luke chapter 3, verses 1 through 22. In the 15th year of the reign of Emperor Tiberius, when Pontius Pilate was governor of Judea and Herod was ruler of Galilee and his brother Philip, ruler of the region of Iturea and Trachonitis, and Lysanias, ruler of Abilene, during the high priesthood of Annas and Caiaphas, the word of God came to John, son of Zechariah, in the wilderness. He went into all the region around the Jordan, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins, as it is written in the book of the words of the prophet Isaiah, the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight. Every valley shall be filled, and every mountain and hill shall be made low, and the crooked shall be made straight, and the rough ways made smooth, and all flesh shall see the salvation of God. John said to the crowds that came out to be baptized by him, you brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Bear fruits worthy of repentance. Do not begin to say to yourselves, We have Abraham as our ancestor. For I tell you, God is able from these stones to raise up children to Abraham. Even now the axe is lying at the root of the trees. Every tree, therefore, that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. And the crowds ask him, what then should we do? In reply, he said to them, whoever has two coats must share with anyone who has none, and whoever has food must do likewise. Even tax collectors came to be baptized, and they asked him, teacher, what should we do? He said to them, collect no more than the amount prescribed for you. Soldiers also asked him, and we, what should we do? He said to them, do not extort money from anyone by threats or false accusation, and be satisfied with your wages. As the people were filled with expectation, and all were questioning in their hearts concerning John whether he might be the Messiah, John answered all of them by saying, I baptize you with water, but one who is more powerful than I is coming. I am not worthy to untie the thong of his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand to clear his threshing floor and to gather the wheat into his granary, but the chaff he will burn with unquenchable fire. So, with many other exhortations, he proclaimed the good news to the people. But Herod, the ruler, who had been rebuked by him because of Herodias, his brother's wife, and because of all the evil things that Herod had done, added to them all by shutting up John in prison. Now, when all the people were baptized, and when Jesus also had been baptized and was praying, the heaven was opened, and the Holy Spirit descended upon him in bodily form like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, you are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased. May God richly bless the reading and the hearing of the word. Passing the torch is a powerful symbol. It's a powerful metaphor. We use it in every area of life, in our families, in our businesses, in churches, in government. Today leads us to think about passing the torch from all sorts of perspectives. We've just entered a new year, which is often symbolized by an old man with a long beard and a walking stick passing a torch to a newborn baby. We are ordaining and installing new elders and deacons this morning, which is a symbolic point at which passing the torch of church leadership becomes real. And we're considering this story about Jesus being baptized by John the Baptist. Luke tells us, even at this early point of the impending arrest of John the Baptist, so it's clear that this is a story about John passing the torch to Jesus. In a larger sense, the torch is being passed from the whole of the Old Testament to the New Testament. Maybe even in a larger sense, it might be possible to view this as God the Father passing the torch to God the Son in the person of Jesus. I love the way that Luke frames this story about the baptism of Jesus. He gives the context for John the Baptist's ministry by throwing a lot of big names around. He says, the emperor Tiberius was in his 15th year of reigning over the Roman Empire. Pontius Pilate was the ruler of Judea. Herod was the ruler of Galilee, and his brother Philip was the ruler of the regions of Iturea and Trachonitis. Lysanias was the ruler of Abilene. The high priest at the temple in Jerusalem were Annas and Caiaphas. These were the names people were familiar with, the names in the daily news, the ones the criers might shout out about. They were the ones people looked to for history-making decisions and events. And then Luke slips this in on us. The word of God came to John, son of Zechariah, in the wilderness. Not to the movers and shakers, not to the religious authorities, not to the palace or the temple. The word of God came to this guy who seemed to be acting out his rebellion against his priest father's religious establishment, no doubt embarrassing his family greatly by the clothing he wore and the diet he ate. Our journey through the Old Testament really should have prepared us for this, though. God calling old Abraham and Sarah to start a family at 100 years of age, living a Bedouin lifestyle, moving from place to place, always at risk. Their descendants would learn to affirm, "Our father was a wandering Aramean." Moses shepherding his father-in-law's flocks out in the wilderness when God spoke to him from a burning bush. Elijah being fed by ravens in a dry stream bed and then living out of the country with a Sidonian widow for years. Hosea being called to act out God's unconditional love by marrying a prostitute. Jeremiah smashing a clay pot to demonstrate what was about to happen to Israel, and then turning around and buying a piece of property as property values were plummeting and the Babylonian army was marching over it and taking possession of it and destroying everything. Ezekiel in Babylon seeing a wheel way up in the middle of the air carrying the glory of God from the temple in Jerusalem to Babylon, where he could be with his people in exile, and then seeing it return to Jerusalem years later. God has been meeting with unlikely people in unlikely places and asking them to do unlikely things from the very beginning. Why should we be surprised by God speaking to this hermit-like figure in the wilderness named John? Called to prepare the way for the Messiah, John takes the torch of the Old Testament prophets and runs with it. "Repent," he told everyone he saw. "Be baptized for the forgiveness of sins. Prepare for the coming of one whose sandals I'm not even worthy to tie. The axe is ready. It's ready to cut down any tree that's not bearing good fruit, and those trees will be thrown into the fire." It's all right in line with the Old Testament prophets whose torch John carried. And when Jesus came to him, John baptized him and passed the torch on to Jesus. You know, when you pass on the torch, you're no longer in control of it. And that's hard. The torch bearer may carry it differently than you did, may take it different places than you did. And such was the case for John when he passed the torch to Jesus. The ministry of Jesus did not just fall in line with the ministry of John or with that of the Old Testament prophets. Ministry of Jesus wasn't all about trees being chopped down and thrown into the fire and judgment and condemnation. Jesus states later on in his life that people were always criticizing John for his ascetic lifestyle, for being so weird, for not eating and drinking the way other people did, and that people criticized him, Jesus, because he did eat and drink and associate with the wrong type of people. They called him a glutton and a drunkard and a friend of sinners. In prison, John began to wonder about those reports he was hearing from Jesus' ministry. And he sent some of his friends to ask Jesus, "Are you really the Messiah that we're looking for? Or should we keep looking for someone else?" That happens a lot when we pass the torch off to someone else. As Jesus submitted himself to baptism, God was pleased and expressed his love for his son and sent the Holy Spirit to rest upon him. The Spirit, the torch, was his to run with now. As Hebrews says, in many and various ways God spoke of old to our fathers by the prophets. But in these last days he has spoken to us by a Son, whom he appointed the heir of all things, and through whom he created the world. The Son reflects the glory of God and bears the very stamp of his nature, and upholds the universe by his word of power. Jesus used the torch to show us the great love his Father has for all of us. And he called us to embrace the love of God for us and to share it with each other. A new commandment I give you, he said, that you love one another. John wrote, God loved the world so much that he gave his only Son, not to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. The gospel is the good news of salvation for all who will accept it. We're going to celebrate communion in a few minutes, a sacrament which shows us just how far Jesus was willing to go to show us the forgiving love which he and his Father have for all of us. This morning we're also going to pass the torch of leadership here at Central to a new group of elders and deacons. It's a great group of folks with a wide variety of life and faith experiences, and they all approach the task with humility and respect. Who knows how God might inspire them to use the torch during their time carrying it? This month brings the end of Barack Obama's presidency and the beginning of Donald Trump's. Nikki Haley is the governor of South Carolina, but will soon transition to the United Nations in New York. Terrence Roberts is the mayor of Anderson. Vladimir Putin leads Russia, and Francis is the Pope. But in what unlikely place and to which unlikely people will the word of God come during our time? In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us continue to worship God now as we present God's tithes and our offerings in an act of stewardship.
Thank you.
God, we are grateful to you for your many gifts to us. We ask that you will help us to be good stewards of all of them. We ask that you'll take these gifts from our hands this day and use them for the work of your kingdom here and elsewhere, that you will bless our lives for your service as well. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. This morning we participate in ordination and installation of elders and deacons for this congregation. One of the differences among different types of churches that you see are in how churches are governed and led. And one of the principles of Presbyterianism is that churches, congregations, have the inalienable right to elect those who will lead them, pastors, elders, and deacons. So we come to the end of a process which began way back in May as you elected a nominating committee to begin seeking God's will for people who would lead this congregation in the future. They met through the summer and prayerfully considered different people to nominate for church leadership. You voted to elect those in September. They have been going through a period of preparation and training for their service and have been approved by the session for service, so today we come to their ordination and installation. The act of ordination is an act of the session of the church, the governing body, so the session is officially meeting this morning in worship for that process. At the appropriate time, I'll invite any ordained elders and ministers who are in the congregation today to come up for prayer of laying on of hands for ordination. We trust the Holy Spirit has been at work through this process and will be at work in a powerful way as these individuals are ordained and installed this morning. So at this time I'd like to call by name those who will be ordained and or installed this morning. As deacons, Mimi Anderson. If you'll just line up on both sides here facing the congregation, please. Jean Kirby, Aaron Lee, Chris Luplo, John Marr, Joanne Phillips, Scott Stewart, Anna Wiersma. And as elders, Bucky Cole, Jim Helvey, Tom Hinchman, Ralph Little, Sidney Mize, Mike Perkins, and April Swanson. All of you have been called by this congregation, by God, and all that's been confirmed through the process that you've gone through to this point. This morning it is time for you to state your willingness to answer the ordination and installation questions and then to be officially installed as service. So we'll be asking you these questions together this morning and we'll invite you to respond to them, please. Do you trust in Jesus Christ, your Savior, acknowledge him Lord of all and head of the church, and through him believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit? Do you?
I do. Do you accept the scriptures of the Old and New Testaments to be by the Holy Spirit, the unique and authoritative witness to Jesus Christ in the church universal and God's word to you? Do you?
I do.
Do you sincerely receive and adopt the essential tenets of the Reformed faith as expressed in the confessions of our church as authentic and reliable expositions of what Scripture leads us to believe and do? And will you be instructed and led by those confessions as you lead the people of God? Will you?
Will you fulfill your ministry in obedience to Jesus Christ under the authority of Scripture and be continually guided by our confessions? Will you?
Will you be governed by our church's polity, and will you abide by its discipline? Will you be a friend among your colleagues in ministry, working with them, subject to the ordering of God's word and spirit? Will you?
Will you in your own life seek to follow the Lord Jesus Christ, love your neighbors, and work for the reconciliation of the world? Will you?
Do you promise, as far as you are able, to further the peace, unity, and purity of the church? Do you? A question specifically for those who will be serving as elders. Will you be a faithful ruling elder, watching over the people, providing for their worship, nurture, and service? Will you share in government and discipline, serving in councils of the church? And in your ministry, will you try to show the love and justice of Jesus Christ? Will you?
For those of you that are specifically deacons, will you be a faithful deacon, teaching charity, urging concern, and directing the people's help to the friendless and those in need? And in your ministry, will you try to show the love and justice of Jesus Christ? Will you?
I will.
Well, these folks have made some big promises, and y'all aren't all off the hook. There are two questions for you to respond to, because ministry is a team effort. It takes all of us working together. These folks will be the out front people for the next few years. They need your prayerful support and your active participation as they lead. So we have two questions for you. Do you, the members of this church, accept these individuals as ruling elders or deacons chosen by God through the voice of this congregation to lead us in the way of Jesus Christ? Do you?
Serving Jesus Christ, who alone is the head of the church. Do we?
At this point, I would like to invite any ordained elders and ministers to come forward for the laying on of hands. I would ask those who are being ordained, if you are able to kneel, turn and kneel. There are some cushions which you may be able to get to and may not, as you're able. And I would ask the rest of the congregation to please stand for this important prayer. Let us pray. Gracious God, in all we turn to you, realizing once again that you always call forth men and women and young people to lead your church, to lead your people. As we look back through the scriptures and note the names of those men and women who have served, who have led, whom you have called from unlikely places, people would have never expected to be leaders, we thank you that you continue to be at work in the lives of ordinary people to change the world. Pray that you'll pour out your spirit upon these who have been elected, who have prepared for service, and are now being ordained and installed to service. Pour out your spirit upon them daily. Fill them with your peace and your presence, and use them in mighty ways in service, not all in great, outstanding ways that we see every day, but in quiet ministries of comfort and compassion and care, as well as in great task of leadership. Pray for our whole congregation that you will unite us in faith, that you will surround us with your spirit and your presence, that you will fill us with joy as we serve you together in this place. We pray all of these things in the name of Christ our Savior. Amen. You may stand. You are now ruling elders and deacons in the Church of Jesus Christ and for this congregation. Whatever you do in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Amen. I invite you to extend the right hand of Christian fellowship to these newly ordained and installed individuals. The congregation will please remain standing and we'll sing hymn 733, We Are All in One in Mission. Seated.
Jesus said, "Come to me, all who are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and I am humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled." Let us pray. Through the words of the prophets, you promised your people the Redeemer, O God, and gave hope for the day when the justice shall roll down like waters, and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. We, your people, rejoice that in Jesus Christ, your Son, the Savior has come, and that he will come again in power and in glory to make all things new. We lift this prayer in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to come together, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power,
and the glory forever.
We as God's people come together and give thanks that on the night before he died, Jesus took the bread as he sat amongst his disciples, and he broke it. And he said to them, as he says to us this day, "This is my body, given for you. As you take it, do so in remembrance of me."
And in the same manner, after supper, Jesus took the cup. He gave it to the disciples, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is given for the forgiveness of sins. Drink ye all of it." We welcome all who have been baptized to this table, regardless of your denominational affiliation. We also encourage you to eat the bread as it's served and to hold the cup until everyone has been served. That way we remember that we have both an individual relationship with Jesus Christ and that together we are the body of Christ. Let us celebrate together. Free this morning. Blood of Christ shed for the forgiveness of our sins. Drink ye all of it. Let us pray. Oh God, we're thankful to you for allowing us to start this new year in this way, to be reminded through partaking of this sacrament that whatever we have done that we think separates us from you does not, that through your Son, Jesus Christ, you offer your freely given forgiveness. Your grace abounds. We thank you for the good news of this table, for the good news of forgiveness and of salvation through Christ. We ask that you'll help us to take this new beginning to a new year and to make something of it for you, to use our lives for your glory each day, to attempt to grow in grace, and to share it with others. We ask all of these things in the name of Christ our Savior. Amen. invite you to go forth from this place into the world in peace. Go nurtured by your presence here in worship and by your participation at the table. Go fed and prepared to serve each day of this year. And may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and grant you his peace both now and in the life everlasting. Amen. Thank you.